There has been a lot of news about ChatGPT lately, like people using ChatGPT to write essays, ChatGPT hitting 100 million users, Google launching Bard to compete against ChatGPT, and Microsoft integrating ChatGPT into all of their products, and also the viral sensation of CatGPT, where it can answer all of your queries, but as a cat. Meow, 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 meow. ChatGPT, if you don't know already, it's a chatbot by OpenAI where you can ask it many things. For example, explaining complex topics like explain why I'm a disappointment to my parents, or ask it more technical questions like how do I inherit more money than my brother from my parents. A lot of people are using it to write essays, draft emails, and even write code. So I tried it myself, of course, as a YouTuber. Obviously, my first question to it was, who is Joma Tech? And it answered, you know, ChatGPT has a lot of limitations. Like here, we ask it to name colors that don't have the letter E in them, and this is what they gave us. Orange, yellow, red. That's clearly wrong. In all seriousness, this is to demonstrate how ChatGPT works. It's a pre-trained large language model, meaning it was trained on text data from the internet until the end of 2021. So it won't know anything about things that happened recently. It doesn't have access to the internet. It will only predict the answer based on what it has consumed already. And the way it answers your question is by predicting each word that comes next. For example, if you ask GPT who Bard is, it's not going to know. You might ask, Joma, didn't your channel launch in 2017 and ChatGPT was trained on internet data until 2021, yet it doesn't know who you are? Yeah, so there's actually a technical reason, and fuck you. Recently, ChatGPT hit 100 million users. It launched November 30th, 2022, and this article came out February 3rd, 2023, so it took 2 months to hit 100 million users. Who are these users and what are they doing with ChatGPT? Well, it's pretty obvious, they're cheating with it. Everybody's cheating, such that some school districts have banned access to ChatGPT. If they can write essays, then they can pass exams. ChatGPT was able to pass exams from law school, business school, and medical school, three prestigious industries. Now, this is why I went into coding, because I always thought that law school, business school, and medical school, it was too much about memorization and you're bound to get replaced. You know, it just wasn't intellectual enough, you know? All right, well, I guess engineering is getting replaced too. ChatGPT passes Google coding interview, which is known to be hard, but I guess not. But note that it is for a L3 engineer, which means it's an entry level. For those not in tech, there's no L2 and L1, it starts at L3. But this does raise questions about ChatGPT's ability to change engineering jobs behind it. And we're already seeing the change as Amazon employees are already using ChatGPT for coding, even though that immediately after they told them to stop, warning them not to share confidential information with ChatGPT. What's happening is they're feeding ChatGPT internal documents, which are confidential, but OpenAI stores all that data. You know, it reminds me of when I used to intern at Microsoft and they didn't let us use Google for searches because they think that they might spy on us. I was like, relax, I'm an intern. I'm not working on anything important. In fact, I actually wasn't working at all. You know, I was playing Overwatch all day, but yeah, anyways, they forced us to use Bing for searches. One thing that's being underreported in mainstream media is the success of GitHub Co-pilot. It's probably the most useful and most well-executed AI product currently out there. Have I used it? No, I haven't coded in forever. Now here's how it works. The moment you write your code, it's like autocomplete on steroids. Like this example, it helps you write the whole draw scatter plot function and it knows how to use the D3 library correctly. Another example here, you can write a comment explaining what you want your function to do and it'll write the code for you. Sometimes even the name of the function will give it enough information to write the rest of the code for you. It's very powerful because it's able to take your whole code base as context and with that, make more accurate predictions that way. For example, if you're building a trading bot and you write the function get tech stock prices, it'll suggest, hey, I know you're going through a rough time, but building a trading bot is not going to fix your insecurities, and maybe you should just accept that you'll be a disappointment for the rest of your life. Okay. How did all of this happen? Why is AI so good suddenly? The answer is the transformer model, which caused a paradigm shift on how we build large language models, LLM. By the way, this diagram means nothing to me. It makes me look smart, so that's why I put it on there. Before transformers, the best natural language processing systems used RNN, and then it used LSTM. But then Google Brain published a paper in 2017 called Attention is All You Need, which is also my life's motto because I'm a narcissist. The paper proposes a simple neural network model they call Transformer, which is based on the self-attention mechanism, which I don't fully understand, so I'll pretend like I don't have time to explain it. But I also know that it allows for more parallelization, which means you can throw more hardware, more GPUs to make your training go faster. And that's when things got crazy. They kept adding more data and also added more parameters, and the model just got better. So what did we do? We made bigger models with more parameters and shoved it a shit ton of data. Sorry, I'm trying my best here to make the model bigger. All right, fuck it. Anyway, that gave us ready-to-use pre-trained transformer models like Google's BERT and OpenAI's GPT, Generative Pre-trained Transformers. They crawled the whole web to get text data like from Wikipedia and Reddit. This graph shows you how many parameters each model has. So as you can see, we've been increasing the number of parameters exponentially. So OpenAI kept improving their GPT model, like how Goku kept becoming stronger each time he reached a new Super Saiyan form. While editing this, I realized how unhelpful the Dragon Ball analogy was, so I want to try again. To recap, Transformer was the model architecture, a type of neural network. Other types of models would be like RNN and LSTM. Compared to RNN, transformers don't need to process words one by one, so it's way more efficient at training with lots of data. OpenAI used the transformer model and pre-trained it by feeding it a bunch of data from the internet, and they called that pre-trained model GPT-1. Back then, NLP models would be trained from scratch for a specific task, like translation or summarization. Both transformer, we get to pre-train the model first, then fine-tune it for a specific task. Then for GPT-2, they did the same thing, but more, and with a bigger model, hence with 1.5 billion parameters. And then with GPT-3, they went crazy and gave it 175 billion parameters. However, just like raising a kid, just shoving it with a bunch of information, unsupervised, might not be the best way to raise a kid. She might know a lot of things, but she hasn't learned proper values from her parents. So that's why we have to fine-tune it, tell it what's right and what's wrong, how not to be racist, and clean up its act. That's GPT 3.5, a more fine-tuned version of GPT-3 with guardrails that can be released to the public. Now you have a decently well-behaved kid, but you now want to show her off. So you dress it up nicely, get her ready for her first job, aka more fine-tuning with some supervised training so it behaves properly as a chatbot. That way it's well-packaged and is ready to ship to the world with a web UI. Okay, back to the original shitty Dragon Ball explanation. So you can think of Goku's hair like the number of parameters, 175 billion parameters, which is why you can see Goku has more hair now. Goku's hair isn't much longer, but it's just, you know, styled a little bit differently. 100 trillion parameters. So technically, GPT-3 was already amazing, but OpenAI was able to package it neatly with ChatGPT, which made it user-friendly, so it became a viral sensation. So yeah, packaging is important. It caused everyone to really pay attention to this. So how did people react to the viral growth of ChatGPT? People were mind blown and said, Google is done, because ChatGPT is going to replace search engines. No, it can't. Until it can search for porn, it cannot replace search engines. Oh wait, why search for porn when you could generate it? Anyway, even losing a bit of search volume to ChatGPT would be a big deal for Google, since 80% of their revenue comes from ads, and most of it comes from search. People were telling Google to release something similar. Google was like, bruh, we have Lambda, which is basically ChatGPT, but releasing it would be risky as they had much more reputational risk at stake and has to move more conservatively than a startup would. That's foreshadowing, by the way. Microsoft is chilling. They positioned themselves really well by investing $1 billion in OpenAI early on in 2019. That allowed OpenAI to leverage Microsoft's Azure for its compute power to train and run their models. And Microsoft gets to integrate OpenAI's tech into their products. So if OpenAI succeeds, Microsoft succeeds. And remember GitHub Co-pilot? Well, GitHub is owned by Microsoft, so that's a huge win. Meanwhile, Google is panicking and issued a code red, calling in the OG founders, Page and Brin. You know, actually, I have no idea who's who, so. Anyways, but they called them to strategize on how to approach this. Microsoft is feeling the momentum, especially with ChatGPT growing so fast and the tech is very promising. So Microsoft invests another $10 billion into OpenAI for a 49% stake in the company. That money can help OpenAI, I don't know, unlock Super Saiyan 4 maybe. Microsoft also plans to integrate GPT into Microsoft Teams, following the same playbook as what they did with GitHub Copilot, which would be huge for them. Google also made some additional moves. Google invests almost $400 million in OpenAI's rival, Anthropic, which is pocket change compared to the $10 billion Microsoft invested. If you don't know what Anthropic is, it doesn't matter. It's like the Burger King of OpenAI. Google goes back on their word about not launching a ChatGPT clone and announces Bard AI, a ChatGPT clone. Remember when I said they didn't want to launch a ChatGPT competitor because of reputational risk? Well, funny enough, that's exactly what happened. The AI made a mistake in the ad and Google shares tanked, losing $100 billion. And I still own my Google stocks from when I worked there. The mistake was, Bard said JWST took the very first pictures of a planet outside of our own solar system. But this astronaut said, no, it was not true. Chauvin did. That tweet alone costed me a lot of money. Anyway, Microsoft responded to the announcement by releasing a new Bing with ChatGPT built in to compete with Google Search. Meanwhile, we have Meta, who is in denial. Meta's AI chief says ChatGPT tech is not particularly innovative. That is just massive copium. Finally, we got Netflix, who's too busy cracking down on password sharing to care about AI. All right, what about us engineers? What's the future for us? The reality is that GPT isn't replacing anybody's job completely. Like most technological innovations, the change can seem drastic because the media loves dramatic titles. But if you are open-minded, you have time to learn about it and embrace it rather than fighting it. If you're a software engineer and you feel threatened by ChatGPT being able to solve FizzBuzz, then you should maybe consider becoming a YouTuber. Just kidding. Please don't compete with me. Though you should incorporate ChatGPT and GitHub Copilot to your workflow. It really removes tedious parts of software engineering. If you're working in a new language or API library, you don't have to Google endlessly for the stuff you already know. Just break down and describe your problem to ChatGPT to get a huge head start. Or get good at coding alongside Copilot. If you structure your code base well and write good comments that describe what you want to do, Copilot often gets the logic problems right. It's a symbiotic relationship. Become the cyborg. See, the trick here is that as a software engineer, your job is to translate and break down a business problem into software problems. Your job is to know what questions to ask and what answers to accept. In fact, here's my prediction. GitHub Copilot is not done innovating here. Their next big product release will turn an issue or PR description into an actual full-blown code commit. So as a software engineer in 2024, you better get real good at writing GitHub issues and reviewing PRs. All right, that's it for this ChatGPT video, but I think this ChatGPT narrative is just one battle of a bigger AI war that's happening between Microsoft and Google. I'll talk about that next time. See you, and thanks for watching. And remember to call your parents.